Welcome at this first English spoken seminar of Bouwen met Staal. My name is Mick Barens from Bouwen met Staal. And
his name. My name is Ocke Bronckhorst from TNO.
And we would like to say something about the applications of structural dynamics. And Ocke is particularly speaking about high-rise structures. I have to click to let people in. Like before, we would like you to turn off your camera and your microphone because it disturbs and could be significantly disturbing to the sound. And questions can be asked through the chat function. I would like to have my presentation now. Is that possible? Do I have to?
Do we think so?
Okay. There it is. Some nice high-rise structures in Rotterdam in the background. And of course, the Erasmus Bridge in the background is also quite famous for its problems with structural dynamics. I will tell you something about it. After our introduction, we would like to just explain something about structural dynamics. This is actually a lunch lecture which is usually organized in Delft, together with the Faculty of Civil Engineering, together with Study Association UBase. And this year they called us and said, well, we are actually missing the contact with firms and with the steel construction industry and with advising companies. So this is their first webinar lunch lecture, and it's opened also for the members of the Association of Bouwen met Staal. After the introduction, I will tell you something about some applications of structural dynamics, and then, like I said before, Ocke will tell you something about specific research about the high rise, wind vibrations and high rise.
Yeah, so something about me. Like I said before, my name is Ocke Bronckhorst. Maybe I can have the, maybe put it in the middle.
Yep.
Yeah, so I graduated in 2008 at the Faculty of Aerospace Engineering. And after that, I started working at TNO. Mainly in wind engineering. We used to have a wind tunnel, a boundary layer wind tunnel, where we did a lot of wind load studies. And yeah, my department that I work in is the Department of Structural Dynamics. We do a lot on vibrations in the built environment. And the last years I've mainly been working on earthquake engineering, which I'll tell in the next slide a bit more about. Then my favorite hobby since I think a year is my daughter. She's 7 years old, and she likes to play football. And actually, since the Corona crisis started, I'm more at home, and we play Kiepie Appie, which is hooghouw in Dutch. For everybody that knows football, they know what I'm talking about, and I'm proud to say that we are currently at a record of 37 times going back and
37.
Forth. 37. 37
between one another.
Between one another.
Okay. And not your individual score.
No, not my individual.
Do you do that inside or outside?
I'm sorry.
Do you do that inside?
Inside
the house
in the street.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So I was saying before, I work in the Department of Structural Dynamics. I'm mainly involved in the work we do in building and infrastructure. Something I've worked a lot on is the development of a shaking table in Groningen, where we did tests on masonry wall components to see how earthquake resistant different products were. We also do a lot of simulation work. I myself am not so much involved in that, but we have colleagues who are very good in it. And then we use this to come up with more simplified models, which can be applied for design purposes. And finally, we also do a lot on safety, so fragility curves for people who know more about this. Then the other part of our department is on the maritime and offshore naval defense. And yeah, there we do a lot on impact, mainly for ships. This is a test that was performed on an LNG tank. And at the same, well, this is the test after, the specimen after failure, the tank. And we also do simulations on this. And the common thread through all this is that we, you know, basically combine lab and in situ testing and measurements with complex modeling to work towards simplified models, which capture the essential physics and are more easily applied for design purposes in practice. So that's a bit about me.
Okay, you know, take it over. Well, I used to have a hobby like keepy uppy, but it's probably 40 years ago. I can't remember my record, so. yeah, Mick Barends, I'd like to, well, for most of our members, of course, know a lot about the organization, but this is part of the, for the study association UBase, we always tell this about Bouwmetaal. It's an organization to promote the use of steel in constructions, in structures, and it's founded by the steel construction industry. We have the whole value chain gathered, so from the producers like Tata Steel, the traders, the steelwork contractors, and the people who apply it, structural engineers, architects, contractors, and students, of course, and teachers are with a total of 1,400 individual members and 450 company members. And we look at ourselves as some sort of a bridge between those worlds, the world of steel, where they do not know much about structures, but a lot about steel, and on the other side, people who know lots and lots about buildings and bridges and know hardly anything about steel. We have some 15 FTE, of course, people in the organization organizing these kinds of events, webinars, National Steel Construction Day, but also specialists on fire safety engineering, detailing, cost engineering, etc. And sustainable building, of course. We do that with these kinds of webinars. We also have education. You can be educated from, let's say, an associate degree to a master degree. We do, yeah, lots about lots with the promotion. We have a technical journal which gives us our name, Bouwmetaal. And some behind the scenes activities like research and lobby. The topic this day is structural dynamics. Well, most of you know what structural dynamics is. It's the classical mechanics concerned with the study of motion, of forces and motion. And it covers the behavior of dynamic loading. Building engineers and structural engineers in the Netherlands are predominantly trained in statics, not in dynamics. Just at the Faculty of Civil Engineering in Delft, there is a course dynamics, but most mechanical engineers and airspace engineers like Ocker here have some training in have lots of training in structural dynamics. Why has it become more increasingly become more needy for the building and the infrastructure engineering in the Netherlands? Well, because we are building more extremely. We're building higher. This, for instance, is a mile high tower, which is supposed to be built in Tokyo, oh, in I believe 2025 or so. Mm. A mile high, 1,600 meters high, and my first encounter with structural dynamics was when I started studying in Delft, not in 65. Then I wasn't even born yet, but the building was built in 65. These are the quite infamous Staalbouw flats, the steel structure apartments at the Menno ter Braaklaan and the Roland Holslaan in Delft. And they were infamous because they were quite shaky. They were technically sufficient, but comfortably insufficient. There was lots of sway. Aquariums would sosh, and well, people even fled the building when it was windy. In 1990, they found a solution. They renovated the whole building and made it more stiff, particularly in the transverse direction. They added some steel, made it more stiff, and I've lived there for a couple of years with, well, it was quite, it was, those were small apartments, 4 by 4 meters, but it was, well, a nice way of living. The second encounter with high rise and structural dynamics was in 1990. In 2003, I mean, why are there now two Luxor theaters in Rotterdam? Well, because one, the old Luxor, had to be removed for the Kool single tower. Okay. This one. It would be the highest tower in the Netherlands with 187 meters, with mast even 250 meters. It was quite slender, and well, eventually it hasn't been erected. But during the design, Zonneveld engineers, Jan van der Wind, came to us and said, well, there's something wrong with the damping ratio. There's something, he thought the damping ratio in the requirements was 1%, which is equivalent to the damping ratio of a steel beam or steel rod. And he said, well, I can't believe that the damping ratio of a whole steel structure is also 1%. So could you please start an investigation, start a research about this? And well, 17 years later, Okke is here and is going to tell something about it. The hope, of course, of Jan van der Wind was that it was too conservative, that there would be a higher damping ratio. I'm not quite sure whether that is true. We'll see later. Another reason of extremity is we're building wider. This is the largest suspension bridge for pedestrians in Switzerland. It's almost 500 meters long and also quite slender, of course. Another encounter I had with structural dynamics was when I visited London in 2000 in June, and the Millennium Bridge was going to be opened. The first day we weren't there, it was too busy, and that was exactly also the reason why at the second day we were there, the bridge was closed, because there was lots of sideway. I hope you see it on this film. What happens here is that people, it was too busy, so there were lots and lots of pedestrians on it. Then they just walked, but they started walking like military people. They started parading, so they started in walking in the same rhythm. And in the longitudinal direction, the bridge could handle it, but sideways, in the lateral direction, the bridge couldn't handle it. It had a mode of 1.2, I believe. It says underneath, but I can't see it because there's something before. And because it's this rhythm of footsteps, the bridge started swaying sideways and had to be closed down. What they found as a solution was they put in tuned mast dampers, which they should have done before, of course, but probably there was too much pressure on opening the bridge. And this is actually a really good solution, which is later on actually has become a normal way of doing it. You build a bridge, you test it, what's its natural frequency, and then you put in the dampers. You can see the dampers here. Those are the tuned mass dampers. The second encounter with vibrations of bridges was the Erasmus Bridge. One of my hobbies, it's hard to imagine, but one of my hobbies was dancing. And in 2003, I was at the dance parade, and the bridge started dancing with us. Same as in London, actually. Of course, there was music, there was rhythm, and the people started dancing on the rhythm and putting forces on, putting loading on the bridge deck. They had to stop the parade then, and a year later they found the solution, and they monitored the bridge. So you were allowed to dance on the bridge, but when it became the deflection became too heavy, the music was stopped and the people would start walking across the bridge, and there would be no problem then. These experiences were put down in guidelines which were in this research project, Human Induced Vibrations of Steel Structures, which is abbreviated to HIVOS. As you can see, the guidelines have been downloaded for many times, thousands of times. Mm-hmm. Also the background documents, and there are two guidelines, one for pedestrian bridges and one for floors. Floors is the second the third structural dynamics application I have been involved with. For instance, for rooftop extensions, you need very lightweight structures, also lightweight floors. And on the other hand, there is an increasing need for comfort. This is also an infamous example, La Fenêtre in Den Haag, in The Hague. It's an apartment building, and actually it was the first apartment being built since the Staalbouw flats in Delft with a total steel structure in the Netherlands. So the client said, I want to be sure that there's nothing wrong with fire and with sound insulation, with vibrations. They built a mock-up. They came to TNO, to your
It was, I just started out.
Suzanne Bron was the program leader, and she set up a research. And first research was actually to have a mock-up with 3x3 houses, and test the floors, test the sound insulation. These were the solutions. You had to have a floating street floor, which is now very normal, but then it wasn't normal in housing in the Netherlands. Also, as you can see, there's lots of mineral wool added, as particularly for the sound insulation, of course. And there were some other measures to have a better sound insulation. With vibrations, there was also a research being done, and which was actually Frank Maatje, our manager, involved in. And finally, there has been built an apartment building which has a high comfort. This was the start of the research. In 2010, during this research by TNO, there another problem arose, also a very famous example. It was the Karel Doorman, a rooftop extension of 16 stories on top of the Termeulen Post warehouse building. And it was a steel structure, timber floors. They were actually doing lots of effort in the design of the sound, but during the erection, a vibration problem arose with the floors. The floors had all the same stiffness, had all same natural frequencies, and actually that was also the solution made by TNO. Make these floors have different stiffnesses, so they dampen out one another when people walk on it. There's even the information of this these two projects and the research were put in this this ongoing research. And finally, the research has been put in the requirements, European requirements for sound, particular, but also for floor vibrations. And a couple of years ago, there was a first version of the computer program Sophist, sound vibration in steel and timber, and it has the ability to create rather simple forms, simple shapes, rectangular rooms. You can model then the floors, the walls, and the steel structure, and also the timber structure if needed. And it's it gives you the sound vibration and the sound insulation and the floor vibration. It has a database with the composite floors, metal stud walls, also the beam. You see there the steel beams. There's a whole database of steel beams in it. The floor system you see there, the SPS, the sandwich plate system, can be put rather easily in the database. Other more intricate floor system and wall systems need more experience to put them in the database. Sophist and all the background information is can be found in at a Dutch website, www.lichterbouwer.nl. Well, we're still planning to have it also in English, but now it's available in Dutch. A final application I want you to talk about is the application Okke is involved with. Earthquake engineering was, which was of course rather renowned in the Netherlands for a couple of years ago, and since 2015 we are very involved in it. A guideline, the NPR 9098, has been published. And we have some complementary technical dossiers about, with some worked examples for different different buildings and earthquake resistant engineering. The National Steel Prize had a nominee in this category: earthquake engineered, earthquake resistant terraced housing with light coach steel framing and a masonry look. So it's light in effect, but it's loose, can even look quite traditional.
I think it's my
my your turn now.
This one didn't work.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Space.
Yes.
I am currently involved in research on high-rise buildings. And specifically vibrations in high-rise buildings. I'll first give a bit of background, and then I'll dive into the details and the harder content. What we see here is a graph I obtained from the Algemeen Dagblad, a Dutch newspaper. And we see in the blue bars show all the residential towers in the Netherlands or in Dutch cities that are taller than 100 meters. And the blue ones are currently existing. And the orange ones are currently under construction or planned for the coming years. And we can see a huge increase, not only in the number of high-rise buildings above 100 meters, but we also see an increase in the height of these buildings. And then especially in Rotterdam and Den Haag, and also now in Eindhoven, there are quite big plans with respect to high-rise building. I have to also comment that these are the residential towers, so these are not office towers that are shown in this picture. The previous slide already showed some trends, and one of these trends is that we start building taller. In the bright picture, you see in the background two towers that are already there, the Rotterdam in the middle and New Orleans around 160 meters on the left. And the Zalmhaven Toren in the front will be the new highest residential tower in the Netherlands. Currently, the New Orleans is the highest residential tower in the Netherlands. So we're building taller, but we're also starting to develop much leaner buildings, much more slender buildings. So the Baantoren is currently planned to be built near the Kooltoren in Rotterdam, which will have a slenderness of approximately 1 to 7, which is currently the New Orleans tower to the right has a slenderness of approximately 1 to 4.5 or 1 to 4. And finally, we are also moving towards more sustainable, lighter building materials, about which we also don't know so much with respect to dynamic behavior in high-rise buildings. So here we see the treehouse, which is planned next to the Rotterdam station, which will, at least for part, consist of cross-laminated timber. So these trends, they have an effect on the comfort level. And we are approaching design limits with respect to comfort under wind-induced vibrations. This graph gives an example of that. So on the vertical axis, we see the peak acceleration level that can be computed, or that is computed with a code, with the Eurocode. And horizontally, we see the height of the building. The orange line specifies the criterion in the Eurocode for residential buildings. So below the criterion, it's considered comfortable, or at least according to the code. And above that criterion, it's not appropriate anymore, or not comfortable. Currently, we build these heavy concrete buildings mainly. There are some examples that Mick was showing before that are lighter, but we are starting to move towards lighter and also like slender, more slender buildings, as I was saying before. And then there is a good chance that we run into problems with this vibration comfort between heights of 100 and 200 meters. So we are approaching the current design limits. So what does a high-rise vibration look like? Here we see a signal that we measured on the New Orleans Tower. We have been measuring on the New Orleans Tower since 2011, both vibrations and wind pressures on the building. And this is a record of 10 minutes during a pretty heavy storm, which also immediately shows like the peak level here is all around 30 millimeters per second square. The New Orleans Tower is a very heavy building, more heavy than even what I showed in the previous slide. So it is a very comfortable building also, at least according to the codes. And apparently also to the people that live in it, I haven't heard any complaints from them.
No, me neither.
If we zoom now in on part of this segment, we can see that it's actually quite a rather sinusoidal movement of the building. It's not very chaotic. Only the amplitude varies quite randomly. And we can also see the period quite clearly, the natural period of the building, which is the time over which it moves back and forth. And for this New Orleans building, the natural period is 3.5 seconds, which corresponds with a natural frequency, which is the inverse of the natural period of almost 0.3 hertz. So these are important parameters, the natural frequency and the amplitude for the to assess and predict the comfort level in the building. Another important parameter is the damping, of which we see a graph here illustrating this. If you have a high damping, then the vibration decays very fast. This is illustrated with the orange line. It's a strongly damped system. If there is no damping, then we have the blue line, and the vibration will, it's a theoretical case, but the vibration will continue endlessly. And high-rise vibrations are somewhere in between. They are very weakly damped. Like Mick was saying before, that's the the Luxor Tower. They use a damping of 1%, which is a very low damping ratio. And this is quite typical for high-rise buildings. For the New Orleans, if we now use this damping ratio and the natural frequency, we can compare the measured values, or we can compute. We have measured a maximum acceleration, which is around the 0.03 meters per second squared. And we've also measured the natural frequency and the damping ratio, which is between 0.8 and 1%. And we can compare that to the two approaches in there are two approaches in the code to compute the peak acceleration level. And we can see, first of all, that there is a big difference between the two codes. So the one code is 0.1 meters per second squared, which is quite close to the criterion level, just below it. And the other code is quite close to actually the measured value, is slightly below. If we also look at the natural frequency, we see that the one code predicts it quite well, the AN1991. But the other one gives a big underestimation. And for the damping, it's more the opposite. So there the damping is quite well predicted by the code, by the AN1990, but not so much by the AN1991. Now, if we look into more detail into this natural frequency, we see here for five towers we have done measurements on in the past, the measured natural frequency, and then the natural frequency obtained with two codes. And we can see that the AN1990 consistently underestimates the natural frequency, and not a little bit, but significantly, up to a factor two in some cases, which is really huge, because it translates to stiffness or mass with to a squared factor. So it could be stiffness, it could be a factor up to four in difference. So in the AN1990, the way the natural frequency is computed is that it's obtained with a FEM model, and it is placed the mass of the building is placed horizontally, and then you get a static displacement, and from that you can compute the natural frequency. So that is the approach prescribed in the AN1990. And the reason that it gives such a conservative estimate, there are ideas about it. We think it's mainly related to the stiffness, and probably the foundation stiffness might also have an influence in it. But it's still not currently not really well known, and we cannot correct for it yet. So. So there is a problem there. And if we look at the AN1991, then we see that it's closer, but it can still underpredict significantly, not as much as the AN 1890. But it can also overpredict the natural frequency. So it's a bit more distributed or spread out over the measured value. And it's interesting to know that this code prescribes an empirical relation, which is based on height. I don't know, people that are a bit familiar with high-rise buildings and dynamics, they know this relation of 46 over H. Well, there are many more. This one was obtained with 46 over H. Which was very surprising to us, that such a simple empirical relationship performs better than a very extensive FEM analysis. The problem with such an empirical relationship, it doesn't give any design freedom anymore. It doesn't matter. It's only the height that determines what the natural frequency is going to be. So you cannot really do anything in your design anymore. So that's also not really optimal for the design of high-rise buildings.
Is this also applicable to what material the structure is?
So you have relations that also make it dependent on the type of material. Yeah, that is true. But this is, I'm now making a comparison between codes.
Mm-hmm.
So what is used in the
design? No, but this 46 over H is...
Is a generally, how do you say... it's what is prescribed in the AN 1890.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
But there are, like I said before, there are many more rules. Like in earthquake engineering, you have various other rules to determine the natural frequency. So the last comment about this is that these high-rise buildings were designed with the rules specified in the AN 1890, so the middle one. If we then look at the damping ratio, we also see significant differences. Here we see for various buildings. At the bottom, we can see that there is concrete buildings. There is a differentiation between concrete buildings, a combination of concrete and steel buildings. And the red squares provide the measured values, and the black line is the damping ratio specified in the AN 1891, and the AN 1890 specifies this 1% for the the surface limit state. So first of all, we can see that both codes don't really predict the damping ratio very well. The Eurocode, the AN 1891, does give, in most cases, a conservative estimate, but it can underpredict the damping by more than a factor 2. And another thing that can be observed is that there is, in these measurements, not really a difference observable between the different types of materials used in the structure. This suggests that other factors might be more important than the materials that are used in the building. I should also mention that, of course, there is also some uncertainty in the estimation of the damping. So there is also uncertainty involved there. I'm not going into further detail into that. That is something we are currently also working on. So between 2012 and 2018, we have performed a significant amount of research on this, and also before, but there was a research program specifically focused on damping in high-rise building. And the idea was to develop models and measurement techniques in which different types of damping contributions could be determined separately. And this research was funded by TNO and various parties from industry. And performed several experiments, both in the lab and also in high-rise buildings. And various numerical models were also developed in this study. I myself was not involved, only at the end of this project. But the people that were involved, a main contribution was made by Sergio Gomez, through a collaboration with the TU Delft and André Mitriky. And his research, and also that of the master students that are mentioned there, has resulted in several relevant insights and results for damping and vibration behavior in high-rise buildings. I already showed a few before, but I'll go into a bit more detail on some of his results. First of all, he developed a method to, it's called the energy flux analysis method, and it allows you to determine the damping ratio or the damping percentage of a part of the structure. So the identification techniques that we have now only allow us to identify, based on measurements, the total damping in a structure. And this technique, theoretically, in practice, there are still some problems, which I'll go into detail a bit further on. But we can estimate for high-rise buildings the damping ratio contribution of the foundation and the superstructure. So he applied this technique both in the lab, which we see on the right, to identify the damping in the building nodes of this structure. And that worked very successfully. That worked very good. He also applied it in situ, where he had to make quite some assumptions for the measurement setup. You cannot measure everything in the building. And that is still a bit of a problem with this technique. He had reasonable results, but it's also dependent on the assumptions that you make. So we two students have looked into more detail into this, and I see that the movies are not working. It happens. I think in the webinar that will be shown later, they will be working.
We will have some hyperlinks to these.
I see it moving very slowly.
it's starting moving now.
So one study was performed by Ikram Talib, a student from the University of Eindhoven. She did a verification study in FEM to see if you had a limited amount of information from your simulation, how well you could predict your damping ratio, and that proved quite successful. The errors were not that big. It also depended a bit on some numerical issues that she ran into.
What do these lines mean?
The lines, they represent the different types of energy in the. So you have the black line, I think, is the kinetic energy. I cannot really see it myself, I have to say, also. Mm-hmm. But there are the different energies in the building. So you have the kinetic energy, the potential energy. So the kinetic energy is the movement of the building. The potential energy is what is stored in the building. So when it's when it's at its maximum, then you mm-hmm. have maximum potential energy, minimum kinetic energy, and in the middle of the vibration, the opposite. And then you get the dissipation is, I think, the red line. I think. It's the different energy contributions from the calculation. On the left is a study that was performed by Michelle Sonneveld. On the New Orleans study, it shows she used the in situ measurements that we performed on the New Orleans tower. And the nice thing about that those measurements are that we also are measuring the wind load, which is quite uncommon to do on high-rise buildings. Mm-hmm. It's quite a lot of work to implement it on a building. And
yeah, what do you mean by that? Is it hard because people live in?
No, this was installed before people lived there.
Okay.
But to maintain the system, and also just it's very costly to, because you have to install tubes throughout the building. Like the
really?
Measurement system is in the core.
Yeah.
Near the elevators.
Mm-hmm.
Or the computers, and then you have your sensors on the outside. So you have tubes of 20 meters running through your building, 10 to 20 meters.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that makes it practically quite complex. So Michele used these measurements to also apply this energy flux analysis method. And she ran into some problems with, there is you have the kinetic energy, or the kinetic energy of the building is determined from the wind load from the wind load that you measure on the building and the movement of the building. So the multiplication of those two.
Mm-hmm.
And it turned out that if there is a phase difference between those two, that has a huge impact on the energy you estimate. So you need to measure very time synchronized. And there are, at this moment, we're unsure where some of these this time difference might come from. We are and that makes the method very sensitive to
But it's a new method, which is by Sergio.
This was a new method developed by Sergio.
Yeah, okay.
So another important insight by Sergio was the influence of the foundation. I'm running over time. I'll go a bit faster. Here we see the ratio of the total stiffness versus the foundation stiffness on the horizontal axis versus the damping, the total damping and the foundation damping on the vertical axis. And we see that if we have a small ratio, that means that the foundation is very stiff compared to the total stiffness, and a large portion of the damping comes from the structure. If we have a very large stiffness ratio, then a large portion of the damping comes from the foundation. We can also see that for a significant number of buildings, the portion of damping from the foundation can be very significant or very large. Because of this, we decided to look for a model that where we can basically determine these two damping contributions separately and add them together. And there is an approach in earthquake engineering that that uses the period lengthening. It's the term T tilde divided by T, which is the T tilde is the period of the building with a foundation, and T is the period of the building with a fixed foundation. So it says something like that. It gives a lengthening if you do not consider if you have a fixed base, and if you have a flexible base compared to the fixed base case. So if we apply this model, we can apply it to we applied it to the New Orleans Rotterdam Tower, and we see here the damping ratios so of the building divided by this period lengthening term for the natural frequency obtained that we can determine with the AN19 1990. And we see that we have quite a low damping, total damping ratio. If we now take the natural frequency of the AN1991, it comes more close to the measured damping ratio. So this shows that it's very sensitive to the estimation of the natural frequency. Which is then an important prerequisite to the application of this model. We need also a better estimation of the natural frequency. Of course, this is only one case, and this needs to be validated mm-hmm. to other buildings, and needs to be further. We also needs to be validated with experimental data of only measurements of the damping of the foundation and the damping of the building. Finally, the comfort criteria. The Eurocode gives this graph for the acceleration, and we see that there is a differentiation between offices and residences, and that high-rise buildings are typically below 1 hertz. So in the upward going lines for the acceleration. So we had a seminar where we decided to also let people experience what it is like to feel these kind of vibrations. We did, so we had a seminar at the Faculty of Aerospace Engineering, and people in couples of two could sit in the Simona and look over Rotterdam while they were sitting in the New Orleans and while the building was moving. Unfortunately, we cannot see the Simona moving, but and we asked people how they perceived this. So we did three short runs, one with a measured vibration level during strong wind conditions. So that's the measurement signal of 50 seconds. Then we increased the level to the service limit state for residents. And finally, we increased it to the service limit state for offices. And we can see that these levels that are on the criteria, so just acceptable, that people at least perceived it. And a significant portion found it slightly annoying or even annoying. And in case of the office service level, there were even a few people that found it frightening. So this is an interesting, simple test. It needs to, of course, be studied in more detail to what extent these criteria really represent what we want to achieve with respect to comfort levels in high-rise buildings. It's also interesting to note the large spread, how people perceive comfort.
And I can imagine that it's also depending on how you, the way you sit or lie down.
Yeah,
for instance.
Yeah, those definitely, you are absolutely right there. The ESO norm also makes a differentiation between mm-hmm. that, yeah. So currently we have started a new project the beginning of this year, where the goals are a bit broader than in the previous project. We want to achieve reliable prediction models for vibrations. And also we want to work towards a monitoring program in high-rise buildings. And the focus is now on three, because we see that the natural frequency is so difficult to estimate currently with current available methods in the code, that we want to look in more detail into the stiffness, what is happening there. Of course, we are also still working on damping, which is one of the focus points. And we are also thinking about working more on this comfort criteria and the perception of vibrations. This project is in collaboration with the industry parties at the bottom. And we are also still looking for collaboration with universities. And there are several research topics that we are thinking of or that can be thought of. So we have, for example, the further development of this energy flow analysis. But we also want to look in more detail in these damping analysis techniques. How accurately can we really predict the damping with these techniques? And there are many different techniques to estimate the damping. And this natural frequency is also an interesting topic. So if there are students that are interested to work on this, then they can contact me.
It's really near the Faculty of Civil Engineering. TNO is you have moved, of course. So it's not the building behind Faculty of Civil Engineering like before, but now it's on the other side of the Mekelweg, I believe.
Yes, we are on the Leegwaterstraat, which is, it's near the Badkuip.
The Badkuip.
I call it the Badkuip. I don't know if it is the Badkuip. I call it the
reverse bathtub.
Yeah, the reverse bathtub. Yeah.
Also, I have some advertising to do, particularly for the UBase association members. Bamestal also gives a trial subscription for a year, free, complimentary. You could go to the website of Bamestal for this subscription, and you receive six magazines in a year, totally free, with no further ties to it. And we have the Student Steel Prize, the Studentenstaal Prijs, with every year many participants from civil engineering in Delft. Last year we even had 15, I believe. So that was an absolute record, not just from civil engineering, also from architectural engineering. And as you can see, you can win prizes, also prize money. Last year, the winner was Roland Koblenz. And actually, he had a topic which had to do with structural dynamics. He worked further with Sofist on the structural dynamics of floor vibration. He had some interesting new insights, which are going to be put in the codes that are continually worked on. The winners of this Student Steel Award are to be put on the podium on the 13th of October. We do not know whether this will be a physical podium. We will organize a National Steel Construction Day at the 13th of October, but we still don't know whether it will be physical or online, or maybe a hybrid one with part physical and part online. Finally, all the information you can be about is the topics we're working on can be found on these websites. Thank you, and I'm curious whether we have some questions. There are no questions through the chat, I believe. Okay. Oh, we seem to be very
no questions.
Ja. Zijn we nog in de lucht of niet? Ah. That was a question to Jan Karel, our technical advisor. We seem to be having absolutely no questions at all. Well, this webinar is going to be it is recorded. It's going to be put on the YouTube channel from Bouwmetstaal. You will receive an invite to that. The presentations with the films with the animations in it will be distributed. And if you have questions, after all, you can ask them to Okke or to me. Thank you. And next week we'll be having three seminar webinars, particularly about the steel construction industry, together with the SNS and ConstruSteel. Go to our website, and you can also apply for that. Thank you. Bye bye.
Thanks, guys. Take care.
Thank you. Bye-bye.